Bam! So you want to identify what domain and range is. When you look at the graph of an equation, well, then you're going to have to know the definitions and the set of all possible input values, usually the x variable, which produce a valid output from a given equation. Or you can say it is the set of all first elements in ordered pairs. Ordered pairs are a grouping of two numbers, which is the domain and range, the left-right movement and the up-and-down movement. Or if you're talking about your graph being on the Cartesian plane, that would be the x, the movement in terms of the x-axis, and then the y value, or the movement along the y-axis. The x value is included in the graph on the Cartesian plane. Okay, so yeah, usually it's x, y, unless you're looking at some kind of graph that is, you know, displaying a real life scenario where there's some real context to what the horizontal and vertical axis are, such as maybe, again, the age being the along the horizontal axis or the x-axis, and your height being along the y-axis. And I'm saying again because I'm going to make this lesson we're watching right now is actually an excerpt of a full-length lesson. The range is the set of all output values from an equation, and it's very difficult to determine what the range is from an equation unless you're very knowledgeable. You have very strong knowledge of what all sort of the parent functions, if you will, like if you know what a standard line looks like, a standard parabola, a standard absolute value linear function, maybe even square root functions and such. If you understand and you know what those parent functions look like, and you're very knowledgeable of, say, translations, and in this lesson is for an algebra class, we haven't even gotten to that yet, I would strongly suggest you create a graph from that equation first before you're trying to determine what the range is. But the set of all output values from an equation, the set of all second elements, usually the y values in ordered pairs. Again, if you're talking about a domain range type organization, an ordered set, that's usually an x and a y value. So let's move on to our three examples. We have here an ellipse, and the domain, it seems like, again, remembering that this graph is made up of an infinite number of points, each of those individual points having, well, I guess maybe there's a couple of points with the same x value, but really kind of each of those points sort of having their own value of x, their own coordinate, right? Because that point, a coordinate, describes how you get from the origin to that point. There's some kind of left-right movement, a negative x or a positive x, and some up-and-down movement, a negative y or positive y. So what values of x are included in all of these points? Well, the domain, you know, looking at that horizontal movement, is going to be x. The smallest value of x that's included looks like it goes as far to the left as negative 3, and then as far to the right as positive 3. And this is a smooth, and actually being smooth isn't really important, this is a continuous graph. So every single, like, negative 3, negative 2.9, negative 2.9, negative 2.7, negative 2.6, 9, 3, 8, 2, 1. Like, any x that you can say that is between negative 3 and positive 3, including those values, would be part of the domain in the range. It kind of looks like an N there. My range then would be all of the output values if I were looking at an equation. But graphically, we are looking at, again, this is the x-axis and the y-axis. The range are all the y values that are included in that graph. Now, again, that graph is continuous, so it seems like it goes as far down as negative 2 and as far up as positive 2, and every single y value is included between that negative 2 and positive 2. So the range is going to be y is going to be greater than or equal to negative 2 and less than or equal to positive 2. And I'm writing these in inequality notation. In a precalculus book, you might see this in interval notation. So I'm not liking the fact that color doesn't match now. In number 2, actually, my air conditioner came on. I know that kind of bothers the video sometimes a little bit, so let me shut that off and come right back. Okay, now that's better. Our second graph is a collection of 5 points, and if I want to list the domain here, then I really just need to write a list of values for x. What, you know, because this is a discrete graph, I can see, chalk down, that there's only 5 points. So we have an x value of -1, a x value of 0, 1, 2, and 3. And my y values are, now I don't need to repeat the same y value over and over and over again. I can just see that this point has a y value of -2. And it is a good practice to write these from low to high. Then we have a y value of, from the origin, we have to go down 1, so the y value is -1. And finally, we have a y value of +1. Okay, and that is how you list domain and range for a discrete graph. Excuse me, you have to just list all the individual x and y values. Now, if I were to come back here and change this example to one that kind of seems to go on forever and is continuous and not focus on those 5 discrete points, well, now my domain is going to be, and I really am intending on writing these in different colors, now my domain, well, this graph goes, it's going up, but it's spreading to the left and spreading to the right forever, so the domain is all real numbers. And so you can say that x is either all reals. You might have a textbook that kind of uses a double R for all reals, or you could say that x is less than, or excuse me, greater than negative infinity and less than positive infinity, because again, it goes on forever. And you can't say equal to infinity because that's sort of like an infinite concept. It goes on forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. And the range, well, the smallest, again, these are all these points are in here now. There's an infinite number of points. And the smallest y value or the point that is the farthest down on this graph, and then from here the graph kind of just goes up forever. So the smallest y value is -2. So the range is going to be y is greater than or equal to -2. And less than infinity, because that parabola is opening up forever, so the y values are just going to keep getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. But the smallest y value included is a concrete value of -2. Now for our bottom graph here, we have a graph that seems to go left and right forever. It seems like there's no breaks in this graph except at 2. So our domain is x cannot be equal to -2. Or you may write that x is greater than negative infinity and less than 2, and x is greater than 2 and less than positive infinity, if your teacher wants you to write it that way. And now the range values get down with it. The range values are all the y values that are included in the graph. Well, the graph is nowhere nowhere do you see a purple line below this horizontal asymptote, this horizontal line that is at y is equal to 1. So these y values are going to get smaller and smaller and smaller. Maybe here it's at 2, maybe it's at 1.5, 1.1, 1.00001. Now, I'm on the left side, right, where the x's are negative, but y is still positive. And it's going to get closer and closer to that y value of 1, but never really become 1. So we're going to say that the range is y is less than 1, or excuse me, not less than 1, greater than 1, unless, now this goes up forever, right? So y is never going to stop growing. So y is less than infinity. Okay. In an upcoming algebra lesson, we're going to be talking about identifying min and maxes. This parabola has a minimum y value of -2, But because it goes up forever and never stops going up, we could not say that there's a maximum value, unless you want to say the maximum value is infinity. But when we talk about identifying maxes and mins in a graph, we're looking for a concrete, like a real answer, if you will. So this graph has a min of negative 2 and a max of positive 2. This function, this parabola, has a min of negative 2 but has no maximum. And this graph is approaching 1, but it's becoming infinitely and infinitely and infinitely and infinitely closer to 1, but it's and coming down from above it. But because there's no concrete number that the graph will actually ever become, this graph also does not have a minimum, or because it's going up forever, a maximum. And if, again, you want to talk about finding domain of an equation as opposed to just finding domain from a graph, I'll have a link to that video lesson above my head, or again, down in the description if you aren't using Flash because you have, I don't know, an iPad or something like that. So, I'm Mr. True. Bam! Go do your homework.